Story has no beginning or end. Arbitrarily, one chooses that moment of experience from which to look back or from which to look ahead. I say one chooses with the inaccurate pride of a professional writer who, when he has been seriously noted at all, has been praised for his technical ability. But do I, in fact, of my own will, choose that black, wet January night on the Common in 1946? The sight of Henry Miles slanting across the wide river of rain? Or did these images choose me?
You want to drown, Henry?
Oh, I wanted a bit of air.
That was the opening of Graham Greene's novel, The End of the Affair. Published in 1951, it was an immediate international success, projecting its author onto the cover of Time magazine. But no one then knew the complicated private story that lay behind this public tale of adultery.
Action!
The novel has now been made into a new feature film, written and directed by Neil Jordan, starring Julianne Moore, Stephen Ray, and Ralph Fiennes in the central role of a writer, Maurice Bendrix.
By coincidence, two friends, separate from each other, had said, you should read this novel because it's something you might like to do. I mean, play Bendrix, I suppose, is what they meant. And I had bought the book to read, hadn't read it, and then sent Neil's script. So then I read it, then I read Neil's script.
It's, you know, an astounding story. I mean, it's really beautiful and very, it has kind of a wonderful, very relatable human scale, but it's about kind of enormous themes. I mean, so it's impossible not to be drawn to it, I think.
It was odd to think that during the war, we could be so totally at peace. There were nights when I wished those sirens would never end.
I mean, the fact that it's a wartime romance, I think, intensifies it.
It's a movie, it's not a novel. And the reason I want to make a movie of the book is not because it's a great piece of literature, which it is, but because it's a great story, you know? And you've got to change books to make them live as a movie. You've got to reassemble the constituent parts and put them back together again in some other way, you know?
The story concerns the relationship between a writer, Maurice Bendrix, his lover, Sarah Miles, and her husband, Henry.
Sarah, this is our neighbour, the novelist.
What on earth is a novelist doing here?
Research.
On what?
On your husband. I'm trying to write a character who works for the Ministry of Pensions.
This triangle is an intriguing echo of Greene's relationship with his American lover, Catherine Walston, and her husband, Harry Walston, a wealthy English farmer. Catherine had married at 18, and by the time she met Greene, she was 30, and already the mother of five children. Their home was the Walston family farm at Triplow, near Cambridge, where one of the children, Oliver, still lives. A boy at the time, understanding Greene's relationship with his parents has for him become a kind of quest.
For me, this is both the beginning and the end. It's the end for my mother, Catherine Walston, because this is where she's buried, only a few hundred yards away from the farm where we all lived. And she's buried here alone, apart from all the other men in her life, apart from my father, who's not buried here, and Graham Greene, who's many hundreds of miles away. But it may just be the beginning of my understanding of her.
It's very strange looking at you, because I'm actually looking at my mum in a funny kind of way.
Yeah.
But you were wearing a hat this morning.
Yeah, I took it off for a
while. She never, ever, ever wore a hat. I'll show you this. The last time I saw Greene, I took this along to him, and he signed it for me. Oliver, son of C, to whom this book is dedicated affectionately, Graham, 5th of March, 1989. This gives me a sort of authenticity, which probably is spurious.
Quite close to him, Graham.
For a period of about 10 years when I was a kid, from about 47 to 57, yes, he hated kids, and the only reason he tolerated...
I know how he feels.
I took it along because I wanted to ask him then how close was the relationship between his real life and the novel.
Does that make a difference to you, knowing it was a story that was very closely based on real events in Graham Greene's life?
As an actor, no. As a person, it's very interesting. I mean, you know, I do believe that most fictional events are based on something real in a writer's life. I mean, that's generally what you find out, that people don't kind of pick things out of thin air. They have something to base it on. So it didn't surprise me. It's always very interesting when you see the way they've kind of distilled something that's happened to them or changed it somewhat, but you realize that the essence is still there.
You say, obviously, Bendrix is not green, but were you aware that the novel was so closely...
Oh, yes, very. I'm only saying that because people keep asking me, are you playing it as green? And I say, no, I'm not. But I know. I'm very aware that it's based on part of Graham Greene's life. But it's sort of not. I mean, it's a very sort of funny grey area.
When Catherine met Greene, he was 42 and already the celebrated author of such books as Stamboul Train, Brighton Rock, and The Power and the Glory. He used his life in his fiction in complicated ways. At the beginning of the war, he was living with his wife Vivian in this South London house near Clapham Common. It was bombed in 1942. Some years later, he used this experience and this location for The End of the Affair. Interestingly, Greene wrote this novel not as his relationship with Catherine was drawing to its close, but during the intensity of their first years together. And one of the first to read it was Catherine's younger sister, Belinda, or Binny, as she was called by her family.
I read The End of the Affair in the spring of 51 from the manuscript that Graham gave me. And I think he wanted some affirmation or critique of it.
Did you give him affirmation or a critique?
I loved the book and I thought it was a marvelous novel, but I was very disturbed at some things in it. I was disturbed that it was dedicated to Catherine, because I thought that it should have been more disguised as a novel and that people would be hurt.
Why do you think he didn't disguise it?
I think he both wanted to be to disguise it and had some pleasure in exposing that the affair was important to him and important to Catherine, and that they loved each other.
Well, I don't know what's love. He was exciting. He was. She may have loved him. I don't know what is. You know. But I don't think she ever would have left Dad for him.
Anne is Catherine and Harry's oldest daughter. Her father was involved in politics and stood, unsuccessfully, as a Labour Party candidate in the 1945 election. In The End of the Affair, Harry appears thinly disguised as the civil servant Henry, whose wife is unfaithful.
It's the first time I read it as a Graham book. I don't like his books anyway. I'm not a great admirer of his books.
So when you reread it recently, what did you think?
Well, I read it as a very personal history, which I didn't like.
A time came when I deliberately told Sarah that I had only taken Henry up for the purpose of copy. Copy, too, for a character who was the ridiculous, the comic element in my book. It was then she began to dislike my novel.
Lots of the comments about Henry, I think, were very apt, I'm afraid. But I think it was very unkind. And to actually call him Henry was even more unkind.
Would you be so kind as to excuse your character?
The Ministry needs him.
Unfortunately, it does.
So, tell me.
What?
His secrets.
Henry's a good man, Mr. Bendrix. Good men have no secrets.
I was afraid you'd say that. You see, goodness has so little fictional value.
What does have fictional value?
A Minister of Home Security.
Are you saying my husband is fiction?
No, I'm saying he could be, in the right hands.
Oh, dear, this is alarming. Can we get away from the service for a moment?
You mean change the subject?
I'm in fresh air, actually.
Of course.
The real beginning of the affair could be traced to Catherine's conversion to Catholicism. For her baptism, she wrote to Greene, himself a Catholic convert, but whom she then didn't know, asking him to be her godfather. He was away, so his wife Vivian stood in for him. Catherine and Graham didn't actually meet until 1 year later. Graham then took her to his favourite restaurant. The same restaurant appears in the novel as the place where Bendrix and Sarah fall in love.
Thank you.
How I wished that I hadn't invited Sarah Miles to dinner.
Cheers to you.
Nice to be here.
We were back at Rules and they had just fetched our steaks. Is it possible to fall in love over a dish of onions? It seems improbable. And yet I could swear it was just then that I fell in love.
These onions are one of the most significant moments in the whole of the book, aren't they?
Yes. Because of the code word. The
code word for sex.
Yeah.
Strange, isn't it? I don't know why, because in the book, Henry hates onions. Mm-hmm. My father never hated onions.
Does Henry like onions?
No.
But isn't this inevitable among novelists? You've got to draw on personal experience. And yes. In this case, he just used a few names that maybe he shouldn't have.
I think that novelists are supposed to be cannibals, but I think many novelists do disguise things better than Graham did. And it was as though it was a jab at your father.
Did you ever speak to my father about this? Did you ever say, how can you stand having your name appear in a book so clearly about your wife?
I did. And he said, well, anything that upsets Catherine, I object to. And my sister, Catherine, was very offended. And she said, you should not have told Graham how to write his book.
Catherine, in a letter to her sister, argued that it was not a cruel book and that Graham was much harder on the writer Bendrix, who was based on himself, than on Henry.
I know every inch of that book and all that Graham meant and felt when he wrote it, and a good deal more than he knows himself. The book is nothing but love, which Bendrix imagines to be hate.
This is a diary of hate.
Although Green's fiction seemed often autobiographical, he himself was wary of the man he chose as his biographer.
I think initially he had the greatest disinclination to have anyone crawling over his life. Absolutely did not want that. And the first thing he said to me was, you are a Catholic, are you? And I said, yes, and his face fell. What he did not want, he was always planning it, you see, was a Catholic. I said, but I'm lapsed. Ah, oh. That's good, that was great, you see. So we started, but he said, there have been so many women in my life. You're going to have to box cleverly here. But who was the important one as far as literature is concerned? I think it would have to be Catherine. And she was damn beautiful, as you can tell from the photographs. Just look at her. And then look at this one. It's smaller, unfortunately, but I think she looks stunningly beautiful there. There she is up there.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's not so much that she's in everything. She wasn't. It's that she provided him with the sense of security, and he was never bored with her, and he could write.
Very early on, after their first meeting, Catherine invited Graham to her cottage in the west of Ireland.
I haven't been along this road for 40-odd years, but it's clear to me, just looking at Dua, which I assume that must be out in front of us, that there are an awful lot more houses than there were, and this was the first time she'd ever had a house of her own. I don't know, it meant a terrific amount to her. It must be. Yes, it is, I can see. The porch, that's exactly what it is. And the photograph is precisely like it. What do you remember about her? Anything?
She had a big Rolls-Royce car. The garage at the back there wouldn't fit in. It was too big for the garage at the back, around the back.
So what did you do?
Extended the garage.
Did you really?
Yeah.
And does the garage still exist?
Well, it's a kitchen now, actually.
And the door
right.
The door there anything used to be here, you think?
So the Rolls Royce would come in through there.
Yeah. The back, yeah.
I see.
That in there.
Yeah. And out the back there, I think there was a lavatory.
Yeah, at the back. Yeah.
I remember sitting on that lavatory with no door, looking at the Atlantic and thinking, this is the most romantic lavatory in the whole world. So who should I speak to round here who would remember?
Paddy Kelly is our name.
Paddy Kelly. Where's he?
He lives out in Morani.
And is Paddy Kelly old enough?
He's about 80 years, yeah. He should be old enough. 80 years.
What's your first name, by the way?
Oliver.
Oliver Walsman.
Correct.
You're very welcome. Very welcome, my boy.
Do you actually remember Catherine Walston?
I do indeed, yes. She's a lovely woman. Tall, good looking.
Really?
Yeah. An awful lot of people knew her. All that end of the village knew her. Very friendly. I used to know Graham Greene. I played snooker with Graham Greene in the pub. He came to Catherine Walston if he'd be writing a book. She was an inspiration more than... I think she taught him an awful lot.
Do you think so?
I think so, yeah. Because the next thing you see an article in the paper about him, Graham Greene, he's writing this book or that book. He was a writer, but it wasn't all his own knowledge. He got it somewhere else.
In Greene's mind, Ackle became a kind of writer's haven where he could work on his books and screenplays, including The Third Man, with Catherine, whom he later begged to marry him, at his side.
The strange thing is that this house is actually, I think, where the affair began. Technically, it might have begun outside Rule's restaurant in Maiden Lane. And 10 years later, in April 1957, he wrote her a letter saying, 10 years ago, it all started in Ackle. And for him, Ackle was everything. Ackle was magic, it was the beginning, and it was obviously a world that he'd never experienced before. The letters do mention sex an awful lot. They mention bare earth floors. They mention waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning and drinking orange juice after sex. And they also mention things like filling up the turf bucket. Obviously, Graham liked having his little job of filling up the turf bucket. It was a sort of symbolic gesture for him.
You'd sit round the turf fire and, make your soda bread and boil your eggs and go off to the little local shop. And it was them sort of playing and living together and being together and, wasn't this fun and jolly and, isn't it wonderful? I think it was absolute make-believe.
You turn it with the sun?
Yeah, turn it against the sun.
When you're going to see. Is that an old wives' tale, or is that for real?
That's for real.
Yeah.
All
right.
Lovely day for it anyway.
It's a perfect day, isn't it?
Yeah.
I bet you Graham never did any of the rowing. I can't see him doing any rowing.
Not an easy job anyway.
The peace of Ackle often contrasts with the anguish of the writing.
Sometimes, after a day when we have made love many times, I wonder whether it isn't possible to come to an end of sex. And I know he's wondering too, and is afraid of that point where the desert begins. What do we do in the desert if we lose each other? How does one go on living after that? He is jealous of the past and the present and the future. If only I could make him feel secure, then we could love peacefully, happily. Not savagely, and the desert would recede out of sight.
The ambivalent emotions in what Greene referred to as our novel found an echo in the self-doubt of Catherine's letters.
She wrote letters wonderfully, very warm, personal, enchanting letters that varied a great deal, went into detail of family, life, friends. She could show that through letters much more than she could directly, except with Graham, I think.
One suffers with and because of someone that you love, and Graham's misery is as real as an illness. And although much of what I do with him and for him will do him no good in the long run, I'm a coward and cannot bear to watch him suffer because of the things that I do. He's very sweet to me and tries very hard, and occasionally, when he fails, he's overcome with remorse.
There's a terrible sadness in them.
A terrible sadness.
And also a very acute perception.
Very acute, and her fear of abandoning him, and her fear of destroying his ability to work alone if she stayed with him. I think that was a dilemma for her.
Catherine Wolston also kept a journal, which is now lost. A key moment in the novel and the film is the discovery by Bendrix of Sarah's journal.
Sometimes I get tired of trying to convince him that I love him and shall love him forever. He pounces on my words like a barrister and twists them.
I remember Graham saying, "Don't you think I got it right there? Don't you think I got it right?" Meaning that he was able to get most difficult for a male, after all, to understand how a female would speak in a private journal about. I said, "You certainly did, Graham. You must have had her journal." He said, "Well, you shouldn't have said that." So it wasn't that he said yes, but I think it was a kind of yes.
I reread this book about 7 years ago, and I thought this would make a marvelous movie. I thought, it's a love story shown from two different points of view, you know? It's the most enduring book that he's written. And I've always felt that Graham Greene has never been done correctly in the cinema.
It's not what I wrote, you know.
I gave
you can't keep saying that. It's true.
I know.
Cut. In the writing, you feel that the situations Greene describes as Bendrix, he observes all the time. He remembers going into the pub and the loo where it says Mary Syphilis and a happy gonorrhea, and you know, he's you feel that as the writer, the writer Greene stroke Bendrix is always observing, always aware, and that's the thing that I suppose is the sort of main fulcrum to what I'm imagining.
He had the bluest of blue eyes. Astonishingly disturbing eyes. Eyes that seem to pursue you. And he's very watchful about everything. I've never met anybody like him.
Curiosity and a horror of boredom took him around the world. From Haiti to Cambodia, Catherine travelled with him as often as family commitments allowed.
He was like a migratory bird, like 100 birds. He never stopped flying. That's what he was like, incessantly moving because of depression. The one person who could take him out of depression was Catherine.
With the money he earned from the third man, Greene bought a house in Italy. Wherever Catherine went with him, she wrote letters to her sisters.
Dearest Bonte, we're on the boat to Capri after a night in Naples, which for me is the most oppressive city in the world with its dirt, poverty and squalor. I feel I gave you a wrong impression of Graham. How good and kind he's always been to me. The only thing I really mind is his own suffering, for which, obviously, I am partially responsible.
She also wrote home to her husband.
Dearest H, first dull day since we arrived. We crossed on the 9:30 boat, and as usual found Aniello waiting with a car and the daughteressa waiting at the villa with hugs, kisses, and groans of pleasure and reproaches. The garden is filled with flowers and vines, and we are well set into our routine.
This labyrinthine garden, as you put it, do you think in a funny kind of way it's a metaphor for his life?
Yes, I think it must have been. That must have been an attraction to him, because he liked secret things. I think there's something of that in most of us. One sees it even in children. But I remember his generation, I think, of being particularly
his generation and people of his education were particularly drawn to that, and perhaps that was public school upbringing, I don't know. But I think the secret life is in his books everywhere.
The writer Shirley Hazard and her late husband Francis Stiegmüller first met Green on Capri in the 1950s. They both had houses there, and in the years that followed, became close friends.
Looking at this photograph, I'm forced to think, it's probably ridiculous, that one's looking at Bendrix and Sarah. I know it's pushing a parallel too close.
I think anybody who's read that book and sees that photograph is going to think the same thing. It's at that time, and look how happy, he almost euphoric he is with her, and yet we know it's not going to last at that level. Why did he stay? Why did he buy a house? I think perhaps your mother, he thought he could be away from England, away from post-war England, and come to an exotic and very beautiful place.
It was on the Isle of Capri that he found her, beneath the shade of an old walnut tree.
There was Somerset Maugham, there was Gracie Fields, there were people, many people coming from England then. He went down to Gracie Fields regularly for lunch.
You couldn't talk about the view because it bored him stiff.
We talked about Dryden. I remember once here we had a conversation about Dryden because we saw some dolphins down there, and he quoted from Dryden, the scaly herd. I don't think dolphins have scales, perhaps they do, but then we started to talk about Dryden. He was an extremely literary person, you know that. He loved English literature.
He was staggeringly well read.
Yes.
Unbelievable.
Yes. Quotations, beautiful. Yes.
It's odd, isn't it, to have that
yes.
contradistinction between total passion about certain things, literature being one,
yes.
and utter
detachment.
Absence of
yes, insight. Yes, sometimes very chilling. He himself said about the sliver of ice in the heart, I used to say the sliver of ice was only the tip of the iceberg.
And did he agree?
Just laughed, shrugged.
So much of a novelist's writing takes place in the unconscious. In those depths, the last word is written before the first word appears on paper. War didn't trouble those deep sea caves, but now there was something of infinitely greater importance to me than war, than my novel, The End of Love.
Do you think The End of the Affair was partially written here?
I think some of it was written here, yes.
Because again, one of the letters I can remember, I can't actually quote it verbatim, but one of the letters that he'd written to my mother was about a novel, Unspecified, which was a total mess. And he was saying to my mother, come out to Capri and we'll make it better.
That and probably was. You can tell from the dates, probably, but that probably was the end of the affair.
It's funny to think that The End of the Affair was written or partly written in these sort of lush,
such a cold, rainy right. London book in many ways.
Cold, yeah. rainy, wartime London, and yes. you're sitting here among all the olive trees and yes. lemons.
Yes, but he wasn't so much distracted as you and I would be by that, because he wasn't so interested in the colours and the lights.
In contrast, Catherine loved the garden, even sending pressed flowers to Harry on his birthday. And from their home near Cambridge, Harry wrote back to her.
The letters that interest me most are the letters from my father to my mother when she was on Capri. And bear in mind that he's sitting back here at Tripler, probably in his chair, and she's out there in Capri. And the first one I have is February the 9th, 1949. It's probably only a year after she and Graham bought the Villa Rosario. And it says, Dearest C.D., happy birthday. I wonder if you'll have a cake, or perhaps Capri doesn't run to such things. But in any case, have a good time. Other letters aren't entirely dissimilar. March the 6th, 1948, from here at Triplow Farm. Dearest C.D., I'm so glad Graham met you at Rome. It was nice of him to go all that way, and must have made things a lot more fun for you. And Capri should be fun too, and probably give you a little rest. What a difference it makes being with people you like. I hope Graham continues happy. In any case, I'm sure your being there helps a lot. Yes. And she would write back to him saying, yes. There's one letter I remember, she describes their routine, Graham's and her routine. They would have coffee at 8:30 in the morning, and then Graham would do his 500 words. Then they'd have lunch.
Graham works. He's now done 1,000 words until about 11 a.m. while I sit in the garden and read. Glass of wine at 11:30 and more reading and music until lunchtime.
Here is a woman with her lover in his, as you say, hideaway, writing to the husband, explaining everything.
It's inconceivable to me, yes. It's like writing from a holiday, and all that was missing is, wish you were here.
In fact, right from the beginning of the affair, Green made regular appearances in the Wolston Family Visitors Book, along with all the other guests.
1940s, there's the first photograph. Graham Green there. May 26, 1947. And there's a photograph of him sitting, actually where we're sitting here, precisely the same place.
Yes, isn't that amazing?
That's 52 years later.
Yes.
Here's my dad grinning like a Cheshire cat sitting out here with Graham with his sleeves rolled up. I mean, he was pretty fastidious normally. And there they are again, sitting precisely where we are. The door is right behind them. And they're sitting round. My father is reading The Observer, so it's obviously a Sunday. And Graham and John Hayward. And here he is, every time, Graham Greene. Graham Greene, Graham Greene.
You know, oh God, Graham's coming. He had to be a bit more careful and a bit quieter, and he didn't like children and he didn't like noise. And, you know, we had to be a little bit more on our guard. Like my mother, who hated reading or wouldn't read books that somebody else had read before. Graham refused to read newspapers that somebody else had read. And a little Jesuit we had staying with us called Father Booth actually read, I don't know, the Sunday Times before Graham had got to it. And it had to be rushed out into the pantry and ironed so that he wouldn't know that somebody else had been there first.
What do you think that tells you about Graham as a man?
Oh, that everything revolved around him.
It. Ray Fiennes, you know, I thought he'd be perfect as Bendrix, you know, because in many ways the movie and the book are a study of male jealousy, aren't they?
I mean, it's since the Greeks, isn't it? It's the relationships and jealousy and envy and desire, and it's Helen of Troy, and it's right the way through Othello. And the emotions are very primitive in a sense, hate, love, wanting to destroy, wanting to manipulate. And in the end, sort of, you haven't progressed any further. And then Green moves in this large chess piece called God into the middle of it. This is a particular God. It's a Catholic God, but in the end, it's still that being up there, and we've made this promise to that person.
I said to God, as I might have said to my father, "Dear God, I'm tired. I'm tired of being without him. And it's all because of you."
Catholicism was always a strong component of both Green's fiction and of his life with Catherine. And they often came to this beautifully decorated 18th century church in Anacapri.
He said he hadn't been to confession for many years because what would be the use, he said, meaning as he didn't mean to stop committing adultery.
But this in a way is one of the themes that runs through all of Green's books, isn't it? The distinction between being a Catholic and sinning and yet remaining within the church.
The commitment and the detachment, yes,
right.
Yes.
Another thing that interests me, particularly looking at that high altar, is that some people have claimed Catherine and Graham, had committed adultery behind every high altar in Italy. Do you think that's just a
You can't get behind that altar, so I don't see how it could have happened here. I really can't say anything about that. I don't know what the source of such a speculation
would be. Oh, the source was an individual who was saying it as a joke.
Yes.
And it's a fairly amusing thing to say.
How anybody could have taken that seriously, because it's a physical impossibility anyway. It was Yvonne Hamilton, and it was at a party of Dennis Cohen, who was the Cresset Press. And I was talking to Yvonne, And she said she was just back from Italy. And my dear, she said, Graham and Catherine were there, and they are committing adultery behind every high altar in Italy. Well, it takes a cradle Catholic, you know, to be able to do that, because after all, she'd been divorced and wasn't above flirtation.
What were your feelings when you actually read, I assume you did read it, the end of the affair at the time? Were you sort of embarrassed? Or?
No, not in the least. I can't think why not. But, you know, I was always interested in Graham's ideas. It always seemed to me that Graham and your mum wanted to tempt God absolutely to the nth degree, and through that got closer to God. I mean, that sinning was almost essential to them, for them to feel any religion. And I think there was a great physical union, which he hadn't had with other people.
She had plenty of boyfriends before Graham.
She had
Graham.
Plenty of boyfriends, but she told me that Graham was the first person with whom she had a nice sex life.
I mean, you know that for a fact, or you just hypothesized?
No, she told me. She told me that Graham was the first person that this had happened with.
I can believe only in love that strikes suddenly out of the clear sky. Because our love came savagely, suddenly, like an act of war. I cannot conceive a love that rises gently and subsides without a scar.
Was she happy?
No.
Never happy?
Well, when she was alone with one of her chaps, but in the end, you see, she wasn't happy with Graham.
No.
Well, the one person who sort of settled her and she had faith in and was a great friend was Harry. And she always said, in spite of all of this, my greatest friend is Harry.
I know of no one who is capable of such profound forgiveness as Harry. What Graham tells you about him would only be true if Harry understood humans and their desires and failings as Graham does. Sex almost never comes into Harry's life, nor does it ever come into his mind or imagination.
Harry's apparent lack of interest in sex contrasted with Graham's obsession, as Binnie discovered on a trip to France with him and Catherine.
We went to Paris together, the three of us, and we had dinner, and then we went to a brothel and saw a pornographic picture, which at my age of, 25, 26, I was absolutely astonished, because I didn't realize that these pictures showed just genitals and not who they were attached to, which was very surprising to me.
And Catherine and Graham, did they love that kind of experience?
I think once in a while they did, and Graham broke the barriers in many ways of a Puritan Victorian country. These things were happening, but in secret. I think he was pushing the barriers about drink, opium, brothels, sexuality, and pushing in ways other people had pushed.
St. James's Street, Piccadilly, from where they all watched the coronation, brought Green and the Wolstons together in an unusual arrangement above Locke's, the fashionable hat shop.
In those days, the entrance to number 6 St. James's Street was here.
Oh.
And then, fairly early on in the relationship, it may have been 1948, my mother got Graham a flat there in number 5.
Uh-huh.
So his door was here.
Yes.
And he was on the first or maybe the second floor.
Yes.
And our door was there. Now this was the living room.
Oh, yes.
Oi.
Look at the hat, sir.
And this is where Mrs. Young lived with her typewriter.
Uh-huh.
Mrs. Young was my father's secretary. But at this stage, Mrs. Young was also Graham's secretary.
Yes.
They actually shared the same
and
secretary.
Why do you think Harry was willing to do that?
I have no idea, but the whole thing is almost a metaphor for their relationship, isn't it?
Yes.
They're living in separate lives, separate marriages, and yet they're physically extremely close.
Yes, absolutely.
This location also found its way into the novel and the film.
These stairs are really creaking still, just like they always used to. One can almost actually, as we go up here, imagine Henry coming up these stairs and listening to the creak like this with the two lovers.
In the room below, on the hardwood floor, with a single cushion for support and the door ajar, we made love. When the moment came, I had to put my hand gently over her mouth to deaden that strange, sad, angry cry of abandonment, for fear Henry should hear it overhead. And then the stair squeaked. For a moment, we neither of us moved.
I'm very uncomfortable about this.
Why?
I don't know. I think it's sort of showing a vicarious thrill about the creaking staircase. And here I am feeling something about Harry alone somewhere.
Do you know, it's interesting. In a way, you're taking my father's side in all this, aren't you? Not your sister's.
I'm taking the side of having some boundaries.
One minute, dear.
What have you heard?
He wouldn't recognize the sound.
Oh, I just wanted to do exactly what he did in the book, really. You know, I mean, he describes an affair that is, the center of it is an erotic relationship, you know, a deeply erotic one, and that's what I wanted to get into the movie, you know. So it'll be quite a lot of, you know, quite frank sex in the film, you know what I mean? But it's not about that, really. You know, it's about more than that.
I think it's really about how much you can love somebody and what it means to you. So it doesn't end up being about morality for me personally or for the character necessarily. I mean, I think it ends up being about how far you go when you love somebody.
You think love ends when you don't see me?
To be is to be perceived. Do I exist for you when you're with Henry?
Yes.
Isn't that why you stay with Henry? Because you know this will end.
No.
I believe that there's a woman that would say, no, I just love you, I want you to be happy, and it's not really important. If I sleep with someone else, then my main thing is that I love you. You must, and I can believe that's a real person talking. And that Bendrix is just at the other pole. He's just not trusting, not even really confidently loving. I mean, I think Bendrix's kind of love is very sort of narrow and male and not really grown up in a way.
I'm sorry, but you have to realize I'm jealous of everything that moves. I'm jealous of the rain.
How can you be jealous of the rain?
I mean, the thing that's interesting about Bendrix is his anger, and anger's not necessarily dark, it's very active. You know, so he's a very, he's because he's a protagonist, he is the most active figure, I think, in the novel and in the screenplay.
I am a jealous man.
He was forever apologizing for losing his temper, apologizing for being difficult, apologizing for being bloody-minded. It doesn't give a wonderful picture of the warm, generous,
very
and gentle
difficult.
Man.
Well, because he was several people, and it was inconceivable that the same person one had had such a lovely time with would then really be so irrationally angry or make trouble. And he liked things to go wrong.
Green could not do without Catherine, but ultimately had to, and therefore recognized that was going to be the case.
Sarah!
She began to fall out of love with him earlier than he fell out of love with her. He was passionately fond of her for at least a decade, 12 years. I'm sure he must have been the most difficult man in the world to live with.
And a letter written by one of the sisters about Catherine, or Bobs as she was often called, revealed increasing tensions.
Last night after supper, for the first time since I came, Bobs and I talked alone. Bobsy, in our short talk, this is not to be told anyone, admitted that Graham's possessiveness and jealousy now gives her only one desire, escape.
But why do you weep as you still read the end of the affair?
I weep because of the anguish of the lovers and the intensity of the love.
And do you think she was at her happiest in her life when she was with Graham?
I think she was. When she was with Graham, but also had Harry waiting at home. But she was very sad when she was ill that she had left, that she had pushed the leaving, and said how much she missed him.
The affair ended in 1959, but Catherine and Graham continued to write to each other until her death in 1978. A letter from Harry Walston to Graham Greene provides a revealing postscript.
And it was written just after my mother had died. Graham had obviously written to him saying he'd heard and sent his condolences. And my father replied, "Dear Graham, I've left your letter to the last to answer because it's the most difficult. I've thought a lot, but still don't really know what to say. You shouldn't have remorse. Of course you caused pain, but who can honestly say that he has gone through life without causing pain? And you gave joy, too. One can't draw up a balance sheet of pluses and minuses. But you gave Catherine something, I don't know what, that no one else has given her. It would not be right to say it changed her life, but it developed her into a far more deeply feeling human being than before. And you gave her a love of reading that had begun already, but deepened because of you."
In tone, somewhat similar to Henry in The End of the Affair.
It's actually uncanny. The tone and the dispassionate, emotionless sense of it could have been written by Henry.
"I did Sarah a great disservice when I married her. I realize that now. I'm not the sort that makes a lover. She wanted someone like you. I'm not sure it's as simple as that."
And then the letter changes. "Yes," he says, "let us meet. Tell us when you're next in England. Love, Harry. P.S. I find I've omitted the ostensible purpose of this letter. To thank you for writing. I do."
Harry Walston and Graham Greene both died in 1991, within 3 weeks of one another.